Hello and welcome to ITV News West Country with Kylie and Sept.
Thank you for joining us. The headlines this Thursday evening. Prime Minister Rishi Sunak tells us asylum seekers will be back on the Bibby Stockholm barge off Portland, but refuses to say when.
We've got to find alternatives, of which the barge is one of the options, but more fundamentally, we've got to stop people coming here in the first place.
Former Royal Marine Penn Farthing prepares to head to Ukraine to support animal shelters, helping abandoned cats and dogs.
Also tonight, a new documentary hopes to help solve the murder of former Crime Watch presenter Jill Dando.
And the Plymouth school children enjoying an interstellar experience with the team behind Cornwall's spaceport.
Good evening. The Prime Minister has told ITV News people seeking asylum will be back on the Bibby Stockholm barge, but refused to say when or how much it's costing taxpayers.
Rishi Sunak stressed the boat is still viable and is a central part of the government's immigration strategy. In a wide-ranging interview, he also discussed housing shortages and building new roads. Here's our political correspondent, David Wood.
We are right in the middle of the party conference season, and today, for the first time since getting the top job, Rishi Sunak faced our cameras and our questions. He has been in the job nearly a year now, and he is a prime minister under pressure on a variety of fronts. So when I sat down with him in Downing Street, I started by asking about one of the most significant pressures he is facing, that of illegal immigration, in particular the barge that's moored on Portland Port right now that's set to house up to 500 asylum seekers, but no one is on board tonight.
Prime Minister, how much is the Bibby Stockholm costing every day?
Well, it's take a step back. What is costing taxpayers every day is housing illegal asylums, illegal migrants in hotels. It's costing us £5-6 million
a day. They're still in those hotels, aren't they? And no one's on the barge.
Yeah, and we're making progress to find alternatives. And that's what we need to do. It's why one of my five priorities is to stop the boats, right? It's not right that taxpayers are forking out up to £5-6 million a day to house people in hotels. We've got to find alternatives, of which the barge is one of the options. But more fundamentally, we've got to stop people coming here in the first place, because my view is that it should be this government and our country who decides who comes here, not criminal gangs.
The only boat you've stopped so far, though, is the Bibby Stockholm, which is empty again today and has been for more than a month. How much is it costing?
Well, we're going through all the checks to make sure that it passes all the vetting and inspections.
Is it really viable? Will people move on board?
Yes, it is. It is viable. It is better alternative than hotels. It's right that we release hotels from local communities. I think across the country, and particularly in the southwest, there will be so many market towns where the hotel has been taken over to house illegal migrants. People don't think that that's right. I don't think that's right. So if we can find large sites like barges and others that we found, disused military bases, that will ease pressure on local communities. But look, fundamentally,
do you have a date then for the barge?
Fundamentally, we've got to stop people coming here in the first place.
I need to move on. As you appreciate, we're tight for time. More than 120,000 people across the West Country are on the social housing waiting list. That is going up. That has gone up since before the pandemic. Is this really the Conservative Britain that you want to be leading, where people are desperate for homes and more than 100,000 simply can't get one?
Yeah, of course I want people to have a wonderful place to call home, whether they're renting, whether they're getting on the housing ladder, whether they're in social housing. Now, we've invested record amounts in developing social housing, so that's happening. But we need to also build more homes for our young people. And actually, the other week, we tried to deal with a bit of defective EU law that is currently blocking 100,000 homes from being built.
That's going to be nowhere enough just to solve the problem
across,
in the West Country, though, is it?
There is no single measure that can unlock more housing. Most of these homes already have planning permission, but they're being blocked by this legacy EU law. Now, we've tried to do that. The Labour Party blocked that. They blocked that in the House of Lords, and that means that we won't be able to get those homes built and people won't be able to fulfil that dream of owning their home. I think that's wrong. And
we're should trying you to do have the a right target, thing. Then, for how many houses should be built? Not just houses, but houses, social houses, should be built each year, so at least people know what you're aiming for.
So if you, I'd say to people, you could go online, have a look at something called the Affordable Homes Programme. That's the government's signature, kind of the flagship programme for funding affordable housing.
Is it working? Because 120,000 people without a social house in the West Country alone.
So we're delivering record amounts of it. Now, I know everyone obviously want this to be faster. I acknowledge that.
Of course, just come from the Liberal Democrat conference where they've given us all little blue bricks in a wall to smash through. And of course, one of the bricks in the blue wall that fell very recently is Somerton and Froome. I didn't see you personally on the campaign trail. Are you running scared of the Liberal Democrats?
No, and look, midterm by-elections are always tricky for incumbent governments, but and we've got a couple more coming up. We're fighting them very hard. I will be out and about as I always am. But the best thing I can say to people is, look, we're focused on your priorities, halving inflation, growing the economy, reducing debt, cutting waiting lists and stuff.
And you'd get them in somehow.
Yeah, but it's important. I mean, you know, those are the country's priorities. Those are my priorities. And we're making progress. But also, just the other week, you saw me do something different on net zero, charting a new course of net zero. That is going to save rural families across the southwest thousands of pounds. They were going to be forced to do things that would have cost a fortune, £5,000, £10,000, £20,000. I didn't think that was right. I took a lot of flack for it, but it's the right thing to do, and it will benefit families in the southwest.
We're out of time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
The Prime Minister and his Conservative troops are all heading to Manchester over the weekend for their party conference. It's his first conference as leader, and he's going to have to work very hard, I think, to reassure many of his Conservative MPs across the West Country. They are worried about the threats from Labour, and in particular, the Liberal Democrats in our part of the country. He will also have to reassure his worried troops that he and Home Secretary Suella Braverman are going to get on top of the immigration issue, and also he and his Health Secretary Steve Barclay are going to do something to bring down the growing waiting list for operations in our hospitals. It is a very tough time for the Prime Minister, and I think he has his toughest few days ahead this weekend since he took the top job.
Our political correspondent David Wood reporting there. Let's bring you some other news tonight. And Devon's mobile libraries have won a reprieve after a campaign backed by stars like Stephen Fry and Michael Morpogo. The County Council voted in July to cut the service to save money, but there was a huge backlash, with 9,000 people signing a petition against the decision. Now their own scrutiny committee has told them to think again.
A warning to people in parts of Truro to boil their water has now been lifted. South West Water issued the notice on Monday following a problem at its treatment works which might have affected water quality. It's now been resolved.
A former Royal Marine will be putting himself in danger again in the next few days when he heads to the war-torn border of Ukraine and Russia to support animal shelters working to protect stray and abandoned dogs.
Penfarthing set up a charity in 2007 to rescue dogs and cats in Afghanistan. Now it's supporting animal shelters in Ukraine. Claire Manning reports.
There aren't many animal charities where your work involves wearing body armour, but in a few days, Penn and David will return to the epicentre of a war zone, the Ukraine-Russian border, where they'll help stray and rescue dogs.
You'll find dogs with collars on that are just so super friendly, looking for their owners who are no longer there, and they're sat outside basically what's just a pile of rubble that used to be a house.
And it's animals like this Penn puts his life in danger for.
Good boy. We'll help you. It's okay.
This footage was taken on Penn's last trip to Ukraine. This dog found amongst the bombed remains of someone's home.
Devastation is just surreal. I still cannot get my head around it. Being a former Royal Marine serving in Afghanistan, I thought I'd seen it all, but no.
Penn set up Nowzad in 2007, focusing on animal welfare in Afghanistan. His dog Ewok, just one of around 200 animals, he flew out of Kabul when the Taliban took control of the capital. But it was rescue work Penn faced criticism for, some saying his focus should only have been on rescuing people.
I still hear today, you know, the pets over people, yet we rescued 67 people. You know, there's young boys and girls now going to school here in the Devon area who have freedom. So I'm really proud of what we did with Operation Ark. You know, those 67 people are starting new lives here in England. And we rescued the animals as well. It was never just pets over people.
Penn's going to Ukraine with three others, among them David.
For me, it's like animals haven't got a voice. We are almost their voice. There's a lot of other charities doing fantastic work for humanitarian aid, but not many actually caring for the animals, and that has always been my thing.
Nowzad isn't taking animals out of Ukraine, but supporting existing rescue centres in the country, building new kennels, fencing, and providing vaccinations and neutering dogs.
And this is just one thing that hasn't been packed already. 50 of these street feeders will be taken to the team out to Ukraine. They'll be positioned in towns and villages that they visit, and they're filled with dog food so that stray dogs just have somewhere that they can grab something to eat.
Mariana is a refugee from Ukraine working for Nowzad.
Our government have no power, time and money to help street dogs, cats, because we have a lot of others' problem. And I'm so happy that Nowzad is ready to help these abandoned animals.
This latest project is costing around £70,000, work the charity says will support animals and brave local people long into what remains an uncertain future. Claire Manning, ITV News.
And you're watching ITV News here in the West Country with Seb and Kylie. Thanks very much for your company this Thursday evening. There is plenty more to come tonight before 6:30, including out of this world. Pupils from Plymouth Primary Schools get an astronomical lesson from Cornwall Spaceport.
And Charlie's joined us in the studio. Charlie, how's it looking?
A little bit up and down, very typically autumnal, and I shall explain why with the help of our good old friend the Jetstream in just a few minutes' time.
Before that, the murder of Jill Dando is one of the most high-profile crimes in living memory and one which remains unsolved.
Well, her brother Nigel is hoping a new documentary will encourage people to come forward with new information. In a moment, we'll be talking to him, but first, let's look back at a murder that shocked a nation.
She was the West Country's golden girl, who became one of the most famous faces on television.
Call me old-fashioned, but there's something rather special about a family day out on the British coast.
Born in Weston-super-Mare, Jill Dando worked as a newsreader for BBC Spotlight in Plymouth before launching her national career. But in April 1999, at the peak of her fame, she was shot dead on the doorstep of her London home in broad daylight.
The news came in that a woman had been killed. And these rumours started going around the newsroom that it was Jill. And it went terribly quiet.
Now a Netflix documentary is revisiting her unsolved murder.
This was one of the largest murder investigations the Metropolitan Police ever had to face.
It was the biggest reward in criminal history in this country.
Today, a man was arrested on suspicion of murder.
Barry George was jailed for the crime, but 8 years later released as an innocent man. Now it's being asked once more, who killed Jill Dando?
Why would they kill her? What benefit would anybody accrue from killing Jill Dando?
The files should still be open on this case. They should be looking.
To be sitting here 24 years on and saying that we still do not know who killed Jill Dando is mind-boggling.
Well, earlier we spoke to Nigel Dando, Jill's brother, who appears in the new documentary. I started by asking him what it was like watching it.
Well, it's a powerful piece of work, that's for sure. Netflix came to me with the idea that they wanted to do perhaps a fuller piece about Jill, her life, what happened on the day she died, and the police investigation to try to catch her killer. It is a thorough piece of work, and it really highlights not only Jill's qualities, what led her to becoming probably the TV star of her day, but also the efforts that the police put in trying to catch whoever murdered her.
I can't imagine what it must be like losing a sibling, but to have nobody in prison for her murder, what does that feel like?
Well, you live in hope that somebody is going to be arrested for the crime and convicted of it and serve their due time in prison. But the police have worked exhaustively on this case, and we just await the day, unlikely to happen, I think probably in my lifetime, but you just don't know. But there's always the chance that somebody may come forward and confess, or somebody who knows something about who did it, they may come forward and give police that vital piece of evidence that is still missing.
Mm. What was that moment like when you heard the news?
Well, I was working in the newsroom of the Bristol Evening Post at the time, and I'd taken a call from a friend of mine who worked on the Daily Mail, who said that Jill had been involved in some sort of accident, didn't know exactly what it was, and he rang back later to say that he thought it was a bit more serious, that Jill had actually been stabbed outside her home and was in hospital. So the alarm bell started ringing, and I eventually got hold of her fiancé, Alan, who told me that he was speaking to me from the back of a police car where he'd been picked up from the hospital where he was working. And they were on their way to Charing Cross where Jill had been taken. And then the call was taken over by a police officer who was with him, who told me that Jill had been pronounced dead at the hospital. So that's how I found out.
Gosh, it must have been the most awful thing that could happen. So many of us, of course, maybe felt like we knew Jill because we saw her on our screens. And, you know, personally for me, I grew up watching her. It was very inspirational to me. But what was she like personally to you as a sister, as a family member?
Well, what you saw on TV was what you got in private. Jill was very bubbly. She was very warm. She was very friendly, very outgoing, very caring. And she carried that over from the screen into her private life. But she never lost the common touch. You know, she was just always Jill. And I think it was the natural qualities that she brought to the TV screen that really made her such a beloved figure. I mean, she was known in virtually every household in the country when all this happened.
It's a real testament that she's so fondly loved still as well.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
Nigel, thank you so much for speaking to us
about
this.
Thank you.
I think Nigel hit the nail on the head there when he came in earlier to speak to us. And when he said she was very natural.
She was,
Exactly, you know, how she came across.
I still remember the moment that when it was announced on the news. It was still such a shocking thing.
Absolutely.
And still to this day, unsolved.
Okay, now the results of a first-of-its-kind survey exploring the lives of black people in Britain have been published today.
Yes, the Black British Voices Project says the results showed there is still much work to be done when it comes to making black people feel like they belong in Britain.
As the results are shared at an event in Westminster, Amrit Birdie has been hearing from the country's first black professional ballet dancer who lives in Loo in Cornwall.
The Black Lives Matter movement inspired millions across the globe to protest against racism and inequality. It also inspired the launch of the Black British Voices Project, a survey of 10,000 black people in Britain, aiming to uncover their real lived experiences.
Black voices matter. You know, we've had, we know some of the disparities, the racial disparities that exist, but we wanted to find out in detail how the black community felt about those disparities. And some of the findings that we found was that just 1 in 10 of those black Brits we surveyed feel definitely proud to be British. And so we have to ask questions about why people are as British as anybody else, actually feel that Britain is not their home.
Participants were asked questions on a range of subjects, from how they identify to opinions on the national curriculum and the media. The study found that 98% feel they have to compromise who they are in the workplace. 95% feel not enough is being done to combat racism in sport. And 1 in 6 black Britons do not consider themselves to be British. And when it came to young people, some of the figures were even more striking, with 90% of young black people expecting to experience racial prejudice as adults. These figures came as no surprise to Julie Felix from Loo in Cornwall, who was Britain's first professional black ballerina.
In our society, things get brushed under the carpet. Something might erupt, as we know things have been regarding black people in the UK. But it's really important that we keep going, keep it alive, keep education going for young people, old people, so that they're made aware.
Leah Mahon has worked with some of the young people that took part in the survey, and she believes the key to change could lie with them.
I think young people should feel inspired that this is the first step out of many reports and surveys and research of what we can do to see how we can move forward as a community. And I hope that this inspires them to speak up.
The government told ITV News that Britain is a more equal place for black people than ever before. But those behind the Black British Voices project say the survey proves that there is still a long way to go.
Right, let's bring you some football news. And Exeter City will host championship side Middlesbrough in the fourth round of the EFL Cup. The Grecians beat Premier League side Luton Town on Tuesday night to reach the last 16 for the first time in more than 30 years.
Now, St Plymouth school children have had a special interstellar experience today in the city centre with Cornwall's spaceport. These children from Ernestel and Torbridge Primary Schools were already full of knowledge and had the best time.
I was in a galaxy and I was in a planet where I could, like, swish things all the time.
I loved going to space because, like, I've seen, like, all of, like, what it's all about. I think it's, like, really interesting. We learn about the planets in our solar system and the geocentric, and that means that the Earth is in the middle.
I kind of like the fact that we're learning about science.
But, like, I'd only go up there once because I want to chase my dreams and be, like, an actor.
Wow.
An actor going to space.
Yeah.
Man, that they'd
amazing.
Look like they had fun, didn't they?
Yeah. It's weather time now. I mean, you know a lot about that stuff, don't you, Charlie? All that spacey stuff. You love all that.
But closer to Earth, if that's okay with everybody, I think, yeah, the idea of space is amazing, but it does terrify me ever so slightly.
Mm. You don't want to go up there?
No, I'll keep my feet on the ground. Mm. Okay. I'd like to see all this sort of stuff from up there, but maybe like them just once, perhaps. Once. It might just be okay for me. And it has been a stormy couple of days, hasn't it? But as we head through the coming few days, we're going to see the jet stream chopping and changing a little bit. At the moment, it's to the south of the UK, where it's kind of on the cold side and quite stormy, so some wet weather coming through tonight. But then as we head through towards the weekend, it heads to the north of the UK, and that allows high pressure to work its way through. So we're a bit up and down with the weather for the next few days.
Whatever the weather, it always feels like home. Valent Heat Pumps and Boilers sponsor ITV West Country Weather.
So then, some wetter weather as we head through the course of this evening, but as we head into tomorrow, a return of some sunshine, lighter winds, a pretty calm and fine end to this working week. It's this low pressure here which is going to bring us some more persistent rain for the next couple of hours or so, but then high pressure builds in through Friday and Saturday, so a fine couple of days. It tries to linger on Sunday, but this next area of low pressure and this front here just want a nudge in from the Atlantic, so we're probably going to see more cloud and in time some outbreaks of rain through Sunday and into next week. Further rain to come through for the next few hours. It turns a little more showery as we work our way towards midnight, and then a bit of a change in wind direction just sort of sweeps that out of the way, leaving us with relatively cloudless skies towards dawn. But it stays mild, lows of 12 or 13 degrees, just a little bit of a breeze first thing. But I think those winds will tend to ease back as we work our way through the course of Friday. It's a fine day as well, a lot of dry weather, a lot of sunshine coming through, very isolated light shower, you'll be so unlucky to see any of those. For most, just some fine skies and temperatures again up to 18, maybe 19 at a push, so in that sunshine it'll feel really quite nice and warm. High tide as we head through tomorrow, Newquay about 20 to 6 in the morning, and again 6 p.m. on the nose. And then on Saturday, not much changes, still got high pressure, still got some fine weather. It's Sunday onwards that next weather system tries to work its way through that we'll see a bit more cloud and just the risk of a few more outbreaks of rain will probably last into next week as well. But temperatures, at least by day, stay on the warm side of average. The nights, though, might just be that little bit chillier. So while we have a bit of rain coming through and a bit of sunshine, always keep your eyes peeled, as Leo did in Torquay. Brilliant double rainbow here.
Valent Heat Pumps and Boilers sponsor ITV West Country Weather.
Very much. That's it, isn't it?
Almost it, Kylie. This is normally about the time I would say goodbye to everyone, but I'm actually rather sadly going to say goodbye to you.
Yeah. This is my last show.
I can't believe I'm actually doing this. This is your last show.
I'm not going to cry.
I am.
Don't cry, it's not me.
It's not going to be great, is it? It's been a short time working with you, but it's been the most wonderful experience. Oh, so thank you so much for that. I am going to let you say something in a minute. But, but first, let's show you some of the amazing memories you've left us with over the last few years.
Okay. Tonight, I'm gonna have it's actually really hard. A real good time. I'm not helping, to be honest, am I? You're doing all the work, aren't you? And the world, I
This is the most visited spot in Antarctica.
Well, a great story there of
the nasty party.
To party in large groups this weekend. Glastonbury Festival coming up tonight.
This is what beautiful.
Oh, it's me. This, honestly... You know what? I think this is the best lineup yet.
Also, you agree with me at long last.
This year.
Fantastic weather.
Are you pleased with the lineup?
Oh, I'm a big Ed Sheeran fan, I have to confess.
My favourite one was where you kind of, right, I'll do my best demo. You like got your hands on your handlebars and then flipped your legs in the air and you're like standing up.
Like a handstand.
That's it.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that a hard one?
Is this your first festival, and if it is, how are you feeling about it?
Believe it or not, 42 years old and it's my first festival, so and obviously the first time here, so I'm excited.
It's starting to look like a balloon now. I've actually lost you at the moment.
You've lost us at the moment.
There we go. I'm finished.
And then you should reapply in a couple of hours.
Perfect. I look great, don't I?
Well, I'm here with Pia now and little Louis, who's been jumping around entertaining us all.
Now, what better place to go when it's cold and we're outside but to the local pub, and here we are. We've actually come outside because we can't get a signal inside, probably because of the weather.
As you can see, and Barry's over there in the corner. He's operating Versius. Speaking quite quietly because they're obviously all concentrating on what's going on here.
Now, the whole programme was being anchored from location. Can I start again? I said rather than whole.
Wow, I bet you all can't wait to see these vegetables, can you?
Yeah.
Now, it's taken months of rehabilitation, but finally they're going back into the ocean. Right, I'm going to say goodbye to you. Good luck.
Yeah, thanks.
I'm proud of you. You'll be fine. Not gonna cry.
Oh, bravo. That is so lovely.
Oh, it's so nice to see all that amazing stuff. I've had such fun. I mean, you can see, can't you?
Yeah.
How much fun I've had here. I'm not gonna cry.
You are gonna cry. I'm gonna cry. I just can't believe you're going.
I know.
I'm really sad.
And I should say thank you to everyone who's watched over the years, because of you, we have our jobs. So thank you for watching, and thank you for the brilliant team that I work with every single day, because you don't see them, but without them, you wouldn't see any of this. So yeah, thank you to you all. You're amazing. Not gonna cry. And now Charlie's got some lovely flowers for Seb.
Yes, thank you very much.
It's been wonderful working with you, Seb, for the last, no, funny you should say, actually, these are for you.
Oh,
thank you for the last 5 years
so
of my
gorgeous.
Career. You've been absolutely brilliant.
Oh.
But as you just said, it isn't just us saying goodbye, because there are lots of people behind the scenes that would like to say goodbye to you as well, right now.
Oh, look! Oh, bless you. Oh, look. So, yeah, look. Oh! Where are you all? There's normally people sitting there. Look. Oh, there they are. There's Downsy on sound. Hello. Kissy, kissy. Oh, Freddie. Oh, Lorraine. That's Tim, our brilliant director. Lucy, Ben in the corner. There's me. Yay. Oh, thank you so much.
We really are going to miss you. We really are going to. Leave me with one eye at least. Thank you so much for all these lovely memories.
Yeah,
we're going to miss
been,
you.
It's been amazing. Thank you so much, everyone who's watched. Yeah, I've loved every minute. Thank you.
One last time. Goodbye from
bye-bye.
The two of us.
Bye-bye.
Bye.